And so today, Monday, June 21st, they finally revealed the set list for set 2 of Overdress, A Brush with Legends. And we got the full set list. We actually spent 2 hours reviewing it with Twitch chat. So actually, I can pull them up real quick here. They have their few seconds of fame right now. But, you know, we spent some time reviewing it with Twitch, looking over all the cards. And I think for a lot of people, we have some, you know, kind of first impressions of the meta. There's already, not of the meta, but of the set. There's already quite a lot of people on Twitter talking about the deck builds, people trying to figure out the decks and how we're going to update them. So let's talk about what the final set looks like, some kind of like key cards, like things that stick out, and of course, rate the SPs and the foils, because that's of course a pretty important factor in this. So let's get into it. All right, so here we are with the actual set list here on the official Japanese website. 212 cards with all foils included is pretty impressive. Before we take a look and talk about the actual decks and how they shaped up, let's talk about SPs, right? These SPs are going to be hot for this set because the encounter cards are going to be popular. I can imagine that things like Blaster Dark and Maka SPs were going to be pretty expensive. These front triggers, I know y'all are going to go crazy for these kind of SPs. Pretty good, pretty good. I think this is the first time we have orders in SP, so I think this one will look really insane. The Hex Orb support is beautiful, going to look great. For me, you know, I like my full Orphist combo, you know, max rarity Orphist, definitely going to be looking for Thumbelinos. And I think the Prison SPs too. And then of course, some of the pieces for Nirvana here are also in SP. And then of course, you know, more goodness. But I think the most expensive SPs will definitely be Battle Blaster Dragon and Dragonic Overlord for sure. These cards always have their own waifu tax, despite not being waifus, just dragons, overlords. You know, it's pretty impressive. I think Verena Elgar looks amazing in as an SP too. So it's pretty cool. I think it's pretty cool. But enough talking about foils and SPs and all that stuff. Let's talk about how this set shaped up. So looking at it first in Dragon Empire, we got three decks now. We have Dragonic Overlord, we have Nirvana, and we have Eugene. I think Dragonic Overlord, a lot of people weren't sure how this deck would end up. I think it's actually quite good. It has good restand pressure, it has a lot of good utility, it has power-up tools, it has the ability to move your opponent's units too, and in general it has all the other good stuff that Dragon Empire has had access to. And apparently from a lot of testing, people are saying that the deck actually does feel pretty good. You know, it's just good old Overlord. It's on-hit pressure, restands, just all that good stuff. So I think it has good potential, and it's going to be just another, you know, basically the 11th / 12th deck added to the arsenal of Overdress decks. Elgar, of course, has turned Verena as a deck away from being just a 3-attack, huge attack, like power pressure deck, into a crazy multi-attack deck, to the point that people are just saying, let's stop playing Valiente and just focus entirely on Elgar, play more soul charging cards, play more cards that help make our Trickstar better. And I think that might actually be the path for this deck. I think that's going to be the first draft for this deck I'm going to be testing out as well, and just basically playing more cards that help to make Elgar as consistent as possible, because we talked about this over the last few weeks, all these effects we've kind of discussed already. You know, you need to play Solas too to overdress in the battle phase into Elgar, who then countercharges. So it's a pretty expensive effect. Of course, the birds every time I start recording start popping off, but it's a pretty expensive effect, so you need a lot of soul charging support, but this deck does have it a fair bit. And then that leaves us with the third Dragon Empire build, which is Eugene, whose sadly highest rarity support is Idris, which is a 5k grade 1 double rare support. I'd say Eugene got like 2 or 3 good cards this set, and if those cards were printed in set 1, Eugene would have been a really good deck. In set 2 though, with the power level here, I don't know how good this is. Like, there's still good cards. This gives power or extra retires, and you also have, like, you know, basically just like more power with like the thing that like stands itself at the start of the battle phase if it was rested. It's cool, but it feels kind of lacking still as before, so we're gonna leave it at that. So looking at more Dragon Empire stuff, this is like Damari that enables that like up to 7 attack pattern for Nirvana, where you go like Damari, who then calls out a Trickstar, Trickstar attacks, and then Elgar's effect, you know, makes it, you go into Elgar, and then use Nirvana attack with it to buff up the Elgar. So you can go up to 7 attacks, pretty crazy. And the Togashirashi is pretty interesting because it's a card that when discarded goes to Soul, And a lot of people were like, oh, well, I don't want to play this. I'd rather run the meeting because this is like, I have to discard it. But in Nirvana, you're discarding throughout the entirety of the game. If you open this in your opening hand, you could discard it for your ride deck and you get an extra soul. If you draw this later on, you're going to discard one to revive a Trickstar with Nirvana. So you're also going to be pretty happy about this because you can discard this for Nirvana. So you get more soul to use the Damari into Elgar combo. So I think that for that reason, this card is pretty neat. And then apart from that, like looking forward, of course, the support, this is like probably the best Eugene support. Then we got some good pieces of Dragonic Overlord support, just gives more power, gives more retires, that kind of good stuff. Of course, every nation gets 20k front triggers, very nice. This card I think is whack. This card is pretty nice for Verena, but more so for the mid-rangey deck that plays a bunch of different Verenas. I think if you're playing just Elgar and Arx, you don't want to discard Arx or Elgar because they are your, like, some of your most important cards. You are happy to discard the regular Verena, but are you willing to run an order just because, like, just for that one Verena that you search off of your ride deck? I don't know about that. So, not too sure about that there. Then looking forward at the commons. This is whack. This is a pretty interesting support card for Overlord. Basically chooses one of your opponent's rearguards and moves it to an empty front or rearguard circle so Overlord can attack into it. It's pretty cool. Gojo is an interesting kind of like generic card. It says when it boosts the Vanguard and the attack hits the opponent's Vanguard, or no, it has to attack any hit anything, you can retire it to countercharge one. So this is actually a generic card that you can use in any Dragon Empire deck to have a countercharge. So that might be good even in things like Nirvana, maybe it's worth testing with. But of course it's designed for Overlord, but I think it's a pretty good card. Countercharge 1 is pretty nice, and you get to actually retire it, which means that there's a big problem card for Bruce in this set that attacks your boosters and kills you, and therefore I think this might be kind of nice. But then looking down here, this is another like Eugene support, count plus one, soul plus one to pop something in the same column as it on your opponent's side of the field. This is like basically Overlord support. This card, they only revealed today, but this is the final piece I think for that like Elgar focus deck. Basically says when it boosts a grade zero for that battle, it gains 5k. So it's a 13k booster, which means that with the Trickstar, that's an 18k column that is now asking for two card guard basically. And that is excellent. Like this is exactly, I think, what it needed to. You know, you're attacking with the Damari, I guess, for like, what, 13? Or does it gain power? I can't remember if Damari gains power himself. Let's quickly check that. Damari does not gain power. So he's 13k, then you back it up with an 18k from boosting with her, and then you go into Elgar with that extra attack. So I think she's a really good card. She should be played as a 3 of, I think, in the Verena deck. So at least I feel like it should be the case. Bar, of course, basically a Conroe, very good card. This is kind of whack, this is kind of whack. This is like a Notagious skill, weird. Really nice Blitz Order, beautiful art, but I don't think we have space for Blitz Orders anymore in Verena. And this is an overdress support card, so yeah, not that great. So that's it for Dragon Empire. I think that both Overlord and Nirvana are really good decks from this set, and I think that I definitely recommend picking up, you know, this, and in general, Elgar just feels like it really pushes the potential of the Verena deck a lot. So I think Dragon Empire is in a pretty good state. Then for Dark States, we have the card that everyone makes a lot of noise about, Lenard. So this card, if you don't know, is basically, we went over it over the last few weeks, you know, you gotta keep up with those Tuesday news videos, because this basically gets 5k power if you're in Final Rush and the ability to attack both the opponent's front row and back row in the same attack. And when it hits anything, you soul charge one, and if your Vanguard is Bruce, you choose a card from your soul and call it to an empty rearguard circle. So it allows for really nasty multi-attacks, and it soul charges a lot, which of course does run the risk of decking out, but it's a really amazing pressure tool. So this turns Bruce into, you know, I've talked to the current world champion Nuno Raimundo, and he basically said the way that Bastion is the best deck in set one, where it's still beatable but it's quite clearly the best deck, that's what Bruce becomes in set two. It's the best deck, but it is beatable because decks like Verena that don't have much of a back row for the most part, decks like Orphist that can just murder their own cards, have a good matchup against this, but decks like Bastion that have a back row and rely on it kind of struggle. And I think this card is definitely probably the best card printed in the set, and I do agree that I think Bruce will probably be the best deck in this meta. We'll see how it shapes up. This is still Monday, the set doesn't come out until Friday in Japan, one more month in English, so let's be patient here. This card is interesting, feels like support for Baromagnus, and we've talked about him. Baromagnus, like every card you use in the early game is used to soul charge and to build up that 15 soul. Well, now they give you Soul Charge cards that are also like tools for aggression, so you can play a more aggressive Barrow Magnus deck that still achieves that Soul Charge requirement. So this might actually be a better card than you think. I don't think it deserves a triple rare spot, but it's pretty good. And then, you know, that's it for Dark States. There's those two decks. The other support for Dark States is basically this card I don't like at all. It's a counter charge they have to discard for. I don't think you need it. And then this is like a generic 15 or 20k attacker that Soul Charges. Could be another potential aggro tool for Barrow Magnus. So I think that, you know, putting it into perspective, I think it does have some potential. Then I think we have another double rare that I missed out on. Yeah, the triple rare, the triple drive enabler for Bruce is not worth it. Is triple drive is just not worth it in Bruce. This is don't fall for this. Don't fall for this. It's bait. It's really not worth it in Bruce, in my opinion. Then moving on, we have like a cycle grade 3 here. There's like a 15k attacker that like disables intercepts, might be worth it. Freeze Breeze is a pretty good card in Barrow Magnus. Basically gets you soul charge and lets you draw two cards if you have 10 or more soul, which is pretty good. I think it's quite nice. Of course, the fronts will be played. Then this is a pretty nice card. Kalmas 1, discard 1 to soul charge 3. And if you have 10 or more soul, you choose a card from your soul and add it to your hand. So like if you soul charge your Oversugar, your PGs, you can take them back. I think this is a nice order to play as like a 2 of maybe. No space for this, unfortunately. And I think just going at the commons here, for Dark States, this card is kind of whatever. It's basically like if you have 4 less soul, put into the soul to give a unit 5k. I don't really like it. This is another like 18k attacker. This is kind of like an opposite Colossus. This card is pretty nice. The Giovanna, she's basically like combos 1 soul plus 1 for battle door effect. It's okay, maybe it's like a 1 or a 2 of. And then sadly, these cards are pretty whatever, but this is nice. The Dober is essentially like after the battle he boosted, if you're in Final Rush, he goes to Soul and gives the unit plus 10k. So with the restanding you do with Bruce, this is pretty good. I think it's actually quite decent. This is quite nice. This has potential. It's like a guard. It's a perfect guard restrict, but has to boost the rear guard. So it's a little bit odd. These cards are not that good. And this is a 20k shield, basically like Blitz Order. I say not that good. They don't impress me too much right now. Let's just say some of these cards don't impress me much right now, but there's been plenty of times where I've been actually like completely like things go completely differently from what I expect. And I could definitely see that happening again. So my impressions here, I think that Bruce is going to be best deck. Personally, I think that Bruce will be the best deck in this meta. Definitely feels like a really strong tier 1 that's like remaining in tier 1. Barrow Magnus will probably remain as like a strong tier 2. I think it got some nice tools. The deck was like already strong by default. It's just going to be a question of like, how does it measure up to the new meta? Because I think the meta will be shaken up a fair bit with this new support. Then of course, Brankgate, my gate. I'm very happy about the Brankgate support because both Orphis, I think got insanely good support, has become a very, very interesting deck. And then Prison has become like, they patched up its biggest weaknesses and gave it an ability to like give even more pressure to the opponent. You'll love to see it. So let's go over Orphis first. Orphis got the ability to like a 15k attacker that also pops your own tokens to pop opponent's rear guards. Also now in the back row, good stuff. Very, very good. We do like that kind of ability to pop opponent stuff. It's really, really nice. And then moving forward, I think into the double rares, we have, of course, the Thumbelino, who it basically makes 38k columns as early as turn 2, and then retires herself and the token in the same column to draw one. So you get to dodge Lennard, and you get to make 38k columns on as early as turn 2. That's pretty nuts. And if you couldn't afford Bobble Mine, now we have this guy who says you can discard a set order to counter-charge 1 once per turn. So all those extra set orders that you have in hand that you like can't even discard for PGs because you don't have enough PGs in hand, you can now burn them for countercharge, which is, I think, is pretty good. It's a really nice alternative to Bobble Mine, so I think it will be played for sure. Then looking at more of the Orphis support, here we have this guy. I quite like him. He basically says like when he's boosted by a token, by the Shadow Army token, and his attack hits anything, draw 1. Doesn't have any cost, no soul boss, no counter boss, no nothing. I think that's pretty nice. I think I'll probably play him as like a 2 or 3 of. This is the top 3 World Searcher. Not worth it. You'd rather mulligan for a world rather than use something like this and clog up your deck space. Here's another potential countercharger, so it's a nice little kind of budget alternative. And I think that's all for, that's the rares. We have, of course, the 20k shield, front trigger. And then looking at the commons for Orphis, we can just scroll down right here. So here we have this thing, which is a Battle Door for Orphist. You soul blast one and retire a token to basically make a Battle Door effect. And then we have some generic cards as well, like if you Persona Ride, 18k attacker, it's kind of whatever. There's like an extra Soul Charge card if you have more rear guards than your opponent. Don't think it's really worth it. This card is quite interesting. Might see play, but I'm not too happy about it. But I don't know, it could see play. At the end of each player's turn, if your world is Abyssal Dark Knight, then you and your opponent both choose a rear guard of yours and retire it. So it's like an interesting Control Orphist playstyle. I could see Control Orphist developing and kind of like using this card as like the crux of that deck. I can see some potential. This is like a generic card. It's kind of whatever. I'm going to try to skip. I don't want to talk too much about everything because I want to just like really pinpoint the cards that seem good, that seem like they're going to be played. Soul, extra Soul Charge for Orphist. Don't think is that needed. And of course, the new world. This one is definitely needed. It's only common too. When you set it, count must one to make a Shadow Army token on turn two. Really good for that early aggression. I've focused on it so much. I've talked about it so much, saying that the early rush from Orphist is really important, and this world helps it a lot. So Orphist looks really good in this set. You have more aggression, and you have the ability to murder your own tokens for resources, which is great looking at what's going to be popular this set. For Prison, you got the Perio Turquoise, who basically like puts that kind of like nerf on your opponent's cards if they free them from the prison. Then, you know, you got this, which is like a PG against Great Tour lower. So this might help when it comes to, you know, stuff like, I don't know, if Bruce is really popular, this will be a PG against things like Eden, things like Lennard. It's pretty great. So for that reason, I think she will be played as like a meta call, but not necessarily at all times. And then looking forward, we have a few supports here as well. This card literally patches up the biggest weakness of Prison. He basically says if you have one or less cards in your prison, you rest it to choose a unit card from your opponent's drop zone and put it into the prison. It's really nice. I think that this card quite literally patches up the biggest weakness that the deck has, and it's perfect. I think I want to play it as like a 3-of, maybe a 4-of. 3-of to try and like mulligan into it. It's just so important for setup. It's really, really important for setup, and you love to see it. And of course, we got this amazing order too. Soul Blast 1 to play it, and if your opponent has 4 more cards in hand, they choose a card from their hand and give it to your prison. And then if you have 3 or more cards in your prison, you give a unit plus 5k power. So I think this order will be played as well, but this card in particular really surprised me. It's an amazing rare for prison. Just really, really good stuff. And finally, we have a few commons in here as well. This one's kind of whatever. I like this one personally. When you place it on rear, you choose one card in your prison and put it into your opponent's drop zone. So if you take something from their hand, you can basically call her to just like put into the drop so they don't get it back. I think it's kind of nice. This card actually was pointed out by Lire in chat, actually might see some play. Her skill is when she boosts, if you have 2 or more cards in the prison, she gets 5k power. A lot of your attackers in prison are 15k. So with a 13k boost, this is 28, which is pretty decent. Like, that's actually pretty decent. There's also like another potential countercharger here, and this Blitz Order I'm a fan of as well, which basically gives minus 5k to the attacking unit for every card in your prison, which is pretty good. So I think Brandgate, prison, of course it kind of depends on the meta, but I think now like the weaknesses have been patched up, I think it's gonna be pretty decent. Probably not like tier 1. I think Orphist could easily be tier 1. Like, I think Orphist only gets better with this set, so I think it's quite good. Then going into Keter, I'm gonna start speeding things up here a little bit. This is a very generic card that like can boost when you Persona Ride, and when the thing in front of it stands itself too. I've seen this played more in Hexa Orb than I've seen it in Bastion, which is, again, the grade 3 focus Hexa Orb seems to be, you know, just going full force. And of course, Final Bastard Dragon is essentially now seems pretty good because a lot of the support cards made it very nice. Like, you can almost one retire 3 to choose 2 of your opponent's rear guards and pop them and then gain 10k power and a crit. Like, that retire 3 became a lot easier this set, and a lot more payoff for retiring too, which is really cool. And of course, you know, Bastion, every single grade 3 that you see here is Bastion support. We have this interesting Pridefall Dragon, which basically gains a crit if you have 4 or more, if you Persona Road and you have 4 or more grade 3 rear guards. I think this has potential as a finisher personally, but we'll see. It is a pretty harsh restriction for the card, and Lennard checks it, so that's another thing. There's a 50k attacker if you have all face down damage. This feels like future support for something, definitely not for the current decks, I feel. And this is insane Hex Orb support. I think Hex Orb is going to look insane in this set, purely because this card quite literally says, Kalamas 1, discard 1, and look at the top 2, and call 2 unit cards from among them. That's really good. that's really, really good for Hexorb. I think Hexorb is looking to eat well in this set, personally, from the support cards that it got. Then, of course, the Overlord support is really good. Blasted Arc is extra drive, check on Vanguard Circle. This lets you cycle a card. This, when retired, if you have a Blaster Vanguard, counts as two cards, just like Karen did in the G era, which I think is insanely good. This order for Bastion is really nice. Extra drive check is great. Also, theoretically, if you have four or more grade 3 units on the board in Hexorb, this is a four drive checks in Hexorb, which is nice. It's definitely nice. So that's those support cards. And then the remaining commons are basically, this is another blaster support. When retired for your card's ability, count plus one, soul plus one, and all your blaster units gain 5k power. So you have Final Blaster Dragon, Blaster Dark, and Blaster Javelin. So this might actually make it like make sense to play Final Blaster, it might make sense to play Blaster Javelin just to give more power. Could be. Not a fan of this card personally. This card is pretty fringe. This is another like control Bastion card, but it's way too overcosted. It's like when it's discarded during your turn, count plus two, soul plus one, choose an opponent's column and bot deck all the rear guards in that column. Count plus two is just too expensive for this. This is a 15k shield. This card is really good. This is the one common that really stood out to me. It says when it's placed on rearguard circle from hand, count plus one and rest one of your rearguards to look at the top card of your deck and reveal it. And if it's an order or a grade three, add it to your hand. And if it's not, call it. This is really nice. This is really, really nice. This is good in Final Blaster Dragon. This is really good, I think, in Hex Orb 2. It just feels really nice because the grade three goes to hand, you essentially get to also just like get a Persona Ride fodder, so it's really cool. Then we have this card is beautiful. It's just a cycle, unfortunately. This is, we talked about before, interesting Hexorb support. This is an angel, very angel-y angel, that tutors grade threes out of your damage zone. And then Javelin, Karen is a pretty good card, of course, basically getting to, you know, rest itself to call from top deck, which is pretty nice. And then of course we have a nice blitz order for Bastion as well, which is a grade three, which is cool. So I think for Keter, PBD looks pretty good because of this card and the rare, the grade 2 rare. I think PBD is actually pretty decent, so I would say it's pretty decent. Bastion will stay good, but I think Bruce checks it as a matchup, and I think Hexorb becomes quite nice. I'm not sure if it's quite like nice enough to go into the high tiers, but this card makes it really, really good. I think it gets really, really good. And then, of course, we have to talk about Stoicaea. First, like for Magnolia, they got a lot of weird cards that have like interesting restrictions of like not being able to be moved and stuff like that. So I don't know if there's enough payoff for that playstyle, but this card was already really nice. And for Zorga, oh my god, there's too many good Zorga cards. This reduces your Canoblasts for your Alchemagics, which is pretty nuts, pretty nuts. So Zorga, there's too many good cards, if anything. This order is insane. You know, this order for Magnolia is not that great because it's a counterblast, and you already counterblast so much with no countercharge, which kind of hurts. Ursula is interesting. She lets you move your rearguards in any way you want during your main phase, so you can kind of get around some restrictions, but you can't get around the move restrictions. You can only get around the place restrictions like Kusi, basically, so that's about it. I don't know. It's an interesting card, but not sure how much it'll be used. I think we'll see as things go on. Then for commons, this is a cool finisher or like pressure card for Zorga. This card's whatever, but this card is pretty insane. When you call it, you put all your bind zone cards into your drop zone, and she gets plus 5k for every card that you put like that. So basically, a way to recycle your Alchemagics. Really, really nice. This card is insane. Oh my god. You choose a rearguard, give it 5k power for every 5 cards in your drop zone, and if you have 15 or more cards in your drop zone, give it a crit. This is also insane in premium. I'm just gonna say it. This card is really, really, really good. But that's the problem for Zorga here. It's like, there's too many good cards. Like, how do you choose what to play here? There's way too many good cards for the deck. I feel like you're stuck at making so many choices. This card in premium is pretty silly. It's an 18k power grade 3 that has a restriction that says you have to call a card not from hand this turn in order for him to be able to attack. So, of course, in premium, you can just stride over and you don't care, and you set on an 18k body during your opponent's turn. It's pretty cool. It's pretty cool. Then you have like a weird, this is like a Vanguard Circle skill, which says like when you play a normal order, you have to bind a card with the same name as that order to Alchemagic. So it's like, it's not really Zorga, and Like, there's a lot of orders, like the Grief, Despair, Rejection, that need a Zorga named Vanguard. So, I don't know, this card's weird. It's like a budget Alchemagic deck, but very restricted. A lot of these other cards, I think, are pretty whatever, but I like this card. A lot of people have been thinking about running this in Magnolia. So, it has a drops on once per turn effect. You can Soul Blast one and choose a order card from your drop zone and bind it to revive it to an open rearguard circle. And so this is cool because you can bind your Ghost Chases, you can bind, the other orders that you play. I think this could see play. Like, this just keeps your aggro going for Magnolia. I think it's actually quite nice. And then the other cards are pretty okay. They're like power-ups or like, you know, mills or can't be moved effects. A lot of can't be moved effects and things like that. There's another nice order for Zorga. Kamas 1 to bind it. And then you choose two order cards from your drop zone, add them back to your hand so you can recycle Ghost Chase, which is nice. And that's the set. That is the set. So I think for Stoikeia, Zorga I think will be pretty insane, but it's really hard to build it right now. Magnolia got a few interesting support cards, but it's going to keep doing the same thing of just like turning whatever it can into aggro and kind of like patching up its defenses, but no counterchargers. Kind of sucks. Kind of hurts for Magnolia, so I think it's kind of lacking in that front. And there's more Soul Blasting happening now too. So that's something to keep in mind. I'm not gonna do any like early rating for the decks. I will start building them very soon and playtesting them on my Twitch. Once again, let's get the chat in here. This is their chance to say hello one more time. So, you know, this is gonna be, we're gonna be playtesting a lot on my Twitch, you know, with all these new decks. I'm especially focusing on Verena, Bruce, Orphist, Prison, and probably going to be trying out the new Ride Lines as well, and Hex Orb. Just over the weeks, as we get closer to the English release, I want to be able to playtest all these decks so I can deliver the deck profiles in English as like during the first week of the set's release, or like first 2 weeks at least. Not, I mean, I took a bit too long with the first set in English purely because of PSFO. So yeah, so I think that kind of wraps it up. But overall, I think winners and losers this set from an early impression standpoint. I think Dragon Empire, really good place. Dark State's really good place. Branke got really good food this set. Keter also got some good stuff. Stoikeia's kind of split. Zorga got amazing stuff, and Magnolia not so much. So overall, this is a really good set. A lot of amazing cards. And what I love about it is that they have taken some decks and turned them from what they used to do and explored new playstyles, like what Orphist is doing, what Verena is doing. It's really cool to see. So I think it's overall a nice set. And generally speaking, I'm very happy with everything that they've printed in this set. You know, a lot of the, you can check all the commons like that they revealed on my Discord on the announcement section. We've gone through it. And so, you know, I kind of went over the most important commons that they revealed, but overall it's a good set. I'm very impressed. You know, quite a few interesting cards that definitely help certain playstyles a lot. So yeah, those are my first takes, first impressions of this set. I'm going to start playtesting, maybe do another early builds video like I did in the past, so you guys can look forward to that as well. But of course, if you want that early, you want that preview, you want to find out as much as possible about, you know, videos before they come out, check out the Twitch, twitch.tv/differentfight. That's where we're at right now. So yeah, give some love to the Twitch as well. And otherwise, I'll see you guys next time. Thank you so much for watching. I got the order wrong. Hold on. But otherwise, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye-bye.